assembly. Thank you for every family. Thank you for this nation. Thank you, Lord, for the love of Christ. We return to give you thanks. We return to exalt you. We return to celebrate you. Indeed, you are worthy. Indeed, you are worthy to be praised. You are worthy to be exalted. You are worthy to be lifted up. Thank you, Jesus. 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 We are so grateful. In Jesus' mighty name, we have given thanks. The words of that song says, "Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry." When they shouted, "Hosanna! Hosanna!" You know what they were saying? They were calling him by his name. They all see us. Hosanna is not a title. Hello? Hosanna means, "Oh, Savior, save me." So it was not by chance that this song was even picked today. Say, "Pass me not, oh gentle Savior." You are saying, "Hosanna, Hosanna, don't pass me, don't pass me by. Savior, don't pass me by. Do something in my life." One of the quizzes all this realm of religion that doesn't make any sense. Everything we do in the kingdom is for a purpose. Are you going to be calling on him right now? You know, after he entered the place, everyone doing buying and selling, he sent them packing. Every illegality in the temple, he terminated it that day. I want us to cry out to God that every illegality in your destiny, in your life, in your body, everything that is trying to sit on your destiny, every devil that is trying to sit on your business, everything that will not let you go, every devil that will not let you prosper, challenge in the last name of Jesus Christ. Call the Savior today. Call the Savior today. Call the Savior today. He said, "Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. Why unknown as thou art calling, do not pass me by." I want us to pray to God today. Say, "God, do not pass me by. Do not pass me by. Send help my way. Send help my way. Send help my way. Do not pass me by. Send help my way. My Lord, I cry to you. You are my Savior. Send help my way." In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus. The blind Bartimaeus, he would have remained blind and died as a blind man. Zacchaeus would have loved many man all his life, if not that he called. He said, he pushed aside every hindrance. The woman with the issue of blood would have died without cancer. But she said, "No, I will defy all the ordinances, I mean all the woman and man-made law that they put to stop me from reaching the Savior. I will go there if I may will touch the hem of his garment." And when he touched the hem of his garment, the power of God, the Savior, he released his saving power, the saving anointing to bail her out. You see, one principal thing or principal dissident of Palm Sunday is supernatural healing and health and wholeness. Thank you, Jesus Christ. What is that angle of your life that you are sensing is having challenges? Maybe your business is sick, normal. Call on the Savior right now and say, "Lord, save me. Send help from the sanctuary. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Lord, send help from the sanctuary. Send help from your sanctuary, Lord. Send help from your sanctuary. Oh, Savior, we call on you today. Send help from the sanctuary. Send help from the sanctuary. We refuse to be stagnated. We refuse to be called sick. We refuse to be numbered among the weak ones. We refuse to be numbered among the failures. Lord, send help today. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, send help from the sanctuary. Send help from the sanctuary. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Blessed be your name, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Lord, as we look into your word, minister unto us in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Terminate our weeping and mourning today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Defend us on every side in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Everything that will not make us to fulfill our destinies, Lord, deliver us today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. You enter the temple, you set back in every temple. He said, my house should be called, supposed to be called the house of prayer, not the den of thieves. No one, the Bible said in John, he said, the thief cometh before to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But here I have come to give you life and life in abundance. Jesus said, my house shall not be called the house of the thief. It shall not be called the house of the devil. The devil does not have his right. He does not have the right to stay in your life. And now leave it. As we are celebrating Jehovah today, as we are celebrating the kingdom feast today, every hope of that thief called devil ends in your life today in the name of Jesus Christ. Every hope of the devil in your career is terminated today in the name of Jesus Christ. Every hope of the devil in your life, in your marriage, in your home, in your lineage, it ends today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Blessed be your name, Lord.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Let's take our seat and let's put our hands together for Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. You are all welcome to his presence. We will be going to today's work. Our time is fast spent. We will try to put as possible to maximize the time that we have. And it is my prayer that the Spirit of the Lord will reveal to us today his agenda for us in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. The Bible says concerning Joseph, said his word came. And when his word came, the king sent for him, and he loosed him. The king sent for him, and he loosed him. That day, every turning in his life ceased when his word came. That day, every weeping and mourning in his life ceased when his word came. The stagnation that was buffeting him for almost 17 years was terminated when his word came. I don't know if you remember that this man was locked in one of the cell with the highest security. Hello? They said he said the prison where they keep the king's prisoners. They don't keep those who sin against the president in ordinary cell. They put them in the maximum security place. And very few leave the place alive, rather. They end up dying. But when his word came, the impossible was made possible. He didn't just release and say, okay, go to the streets of their headquarters in Egypt then and just be selling orange. No, he took him from the prison to the palace. Your word that will take you from the prison of life to the palace will be sent today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. The Lord spoke to him and said, we rule and reign by divine wisdom. Brethren, I want you to understand, under no circumstance, you are not created to be under. You are not created to be subdued. You are not created to be a servant. You are not created to be a byword. You are not created to get to a place where people are shaking their heads. Oh, he has come again. Just looking on time for time. When will we go? You are not created that people will be looking at you and they'll be shaking their heads. Oh, he's suffering. You are not created to be a byword. You are created to be a city that is set on the hill. Thank you, Jesus. You are created to be the salt of the earth. You are created to be a reference point, irrespective of where you are, irrespective of where you were born, irrespective of your language, irrespective of your lineage, irrespective of your sex, whether you are a male or female, it doesn't make a difference. You are created in Christ Jesus to rule and to reign. Thank you, Jesus. And this one, I want us to allow it to sink deep into our memory. Because what you don't believe, you can never become. He said in his word, he said to them that believe, he gave them the power to become what they believe. And you cannot believe what you don't know about. You know, some people, they have been mentally caged to believe that they are supposed to be slaves. Thank you, Jesus. You cannot be truly free until your mind is set free, until your mind is liberated. That's the same reason when God wanted to change the world, when God wanted to make a difference in the world, he did not send his only begotten son as a soldier. He did not send his only begotten son as a military leader. He didn't even send him renewing of your mind. Until your mind is renewed, your life cannot be transformed. Hello? Take a man with slavery mentality and put him in the palace. He will still be behaving as a slave. Remember the story we used to read when we were growing up, that a rich man that went to a place and with his servant, and that guy said, okay, please, okay, as you are going to today, please, at least respect me small. Give me a very nice cloth, and when you get there, don't call me your servant. I said, the man said, okay, fine, I will respect that. I will respect your wish, let's go together. So he gave him a very nice cloth, he dressed with his boss, and they went. Hello? And while they were there, after they finished eating, dinner, this man said, well, by the time I get back to my Oga's house tomorrow, I may not have enough food. He went and sneaked back to the kitchen. I started eating from the bottom. And when they spotted him, they see, they have proved that you are a slave now. Even though we give you the kingly cloth, we treated you as a king, but you have proved that you are a slave. What makes a slave is not where you are found. What makes a person a slave is his mind. Until your mind is enslaved, your destiny cannot be enslaved. Hello? Those who are going around blowing themselves, what do you think the devil did for them? They don't go to hijack them. They hardly do that. No. They brainwash them. Hello? They brainwash them. They enslave their mind and lie to them that if you go to this, the more people you kill, the more God loves you. The more your rating in the kingdom of their own God. So at once they're able to get their mind, they willingly surrender themselves to not carry that evil. And that's why the Bible said, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. No wonder we are treating the issue of wisdom this month, because wisdom is the seat of wisdom is the mind. Hello? The seat of wisdom is the mind. You can never see a man who doesn't have a sound mind that has a sound life. It's not possible. Hello? A sound mind will naturally give you a sound life. Until your mind is renewed, your life cannot be transformed. Job 28. Let's start from verse 7 to save our time. Job chapter 28. Job is the book before Psalms. Psalms in the middle of the Bible, so it's very easy. Just divide your Bible from the center and just open a few pages. And Job 27:28 and verse 7 said, there is a part which no fowl knoweth, and which the vulture's eyes has not seen. The lion's whelp have not trodden it, nor the fierce lion passed by it. He putteth forth his hand upon the rocks. He overturneth the mountains by the rock. Talking about wisdom. That wisdom has the capacity to do what? To upturn rock. I mean, he has the capacity to overturn the mountains by the roots. Huh? No matter how high the mountain of your life is, the wisdom of God will overturn it in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Like one man of God said, that there is no mountain anywhere. Your ignorance is your mountain. And it is very true, sir. You remember some way, they say caterpillar or cocaine. You know, in the old time when you see a mountain and you want to say, oh, this is uncoiled, you can't use it. But if you have a bulldozer, especially if you have like D6 or D9 or D12, you will level it. If you have some rock somewhere and you say, okay, what are we going to do now? Just drill it. Put your explosive there. Hello? Well, I don't know that Pastor Robert, they are doing something like that recently. I mean, if you see what they were doing, they actually plastered that rock and constructed a nice edifice on the top of the rock. Naturally, if you don't have the wisdom to do that, you'll have said, no, it's not possible. Let's abandon that land. Let's go for somewhere. But what I'm trying to say is that wisdom has the capacity to overturn the mountain by the roots. Which means that the challenges of your life will not be taken care of just on the surface level. The wisdom of God will overturn it. Hello, sir. Because God may not understand that whatever it dwells shall be forever.
God
cannot quench the trouble in your home and still coming back and saying, oh. If the wisdom of God is one that has quenched the fire, he will quench it forever. Hallelujah. See, the wisdom of God cannot be compared to the wisdom of man. I remember, I won't mention that nation. There was still one devil, some devils packaged themselves together and said, let's introduce Sharia. And then the president of that nation was a Christian. You see, naturally, he would have reacted and said, no, let's roll tanks into the street and go and quench them. But the word of God can say, no, don't do that. Take it easy. Because what they were actually targeting was for you to mishear or to say something against and take another advantage to mess up the nation. Because they're Christian. Say, keep quiet. Say that Sharia will go the way it came. Was it not flushed out? It disappeared. You can never compare the wisdom of God with the wisdom of man. No wonder the scripture we read yesterday in the book of Peter, he said Jesus did not react to them the way they were talking to him. Remember, when we were talking about the rules, the introduction that I said, Jesus would have said, okay, what were you? No, I won't listen. You are stupid. You are that. He said, when they did everything to him, he revived them. He did not react that way. Otherwise, they would have provoked him to sin. If he had sinned or committed any sin, he would have wasted his life because his sacrifice would not more be acceptable, sir. Hallelujah to Jesus. Wisdom was at work. They said everything to him. Bible said he did not commit sin by acting. He did not say there was no guile in his mouth. So he did not simply speak evil. He takes the wisdom of God to do that. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Let's go ahead. Hallelujah. He said in verse 8. No, we read we're going to 10 now. He said he cutted out rivers among the rocks, and his eye seared every precious thing. Still talking about wisdom. He said, he binded the floods from overflowing, and the thing that is hid bringeth he forth to light. See, wisdom has the capacity, the ability to bind the flood. No wonder. The Bible said that when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of God lift up a standard against it. There is no human-made device that has the capacity to stop any flood, sir, except the wisdom of God. Go and check all the documentaries. They can only predict it and say it's coming and pack the people out of it. When tornado is coming, what do? They pack people out of it. They will say, okay, go and bring the bulldozer and put in there. Both the bulldozer and whatever, you carry them. It takes the wisdom of God to handle the flood. And the enemy is trying to flood your family. He's trying to flood your life. He's trying to flood your children. He's trying to flood your career. He's trying to flood your business. But the wisdom of God has the capacity to what? To stop it. I see the wisdom of God chasing away every storm, every flood of your life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. He said he binded the floods from overflowing. And in the things that is in here, I mean, he bring them forth to light. Now, if wisdom can do all these things, where then can we get it? Remember last week we said, wisdom is simply obedience to the word of God. Or correct application of knowledge. Wisdom can also be defined as doing what is required to acquire what you desire. Doing what is required to acquire what you desire. What do you desire? I desire supernatural health. What is required of me? I have to eat well. What is required of me? I have to speak right. What is required of me? I don't go around taking sickness. I don't go around talking sickness. So, doing what is required to acquire what is the desire is called wisdom. But now, we're going to be dealing today quickly with the source of wisdom. How can I get wisdom? Where is this wisdom available? Remember also we said that there are four kinds of wisdom, basically. We have the natural wisdom. That when a child is crying, he doesn't use his leg to cry. He uses his mouth. You don't say, oh, I'm hungry that day, give me food, and he puts his leg to you like this. No, you can't do that. that super knowledge that is above all every other kind of wisdom. But where then do we get that kind of wisdom that we're talking about? Remember, that kind of wisdom has ability to handle death, he has ability to handle flood, he has ability to overturn mountains. Where can we get that kind of wisdom? Do we go to the shop and say, okay, I want to buy wisdom? Hallelujah. Like somebody said in Nigeria, somebody was evangelizing and said, okay, do you know Jesus in your life? And this woman has never heard about Jesus before. Say, and she was selling something and brought down the calabash and what was there. I said, okay, please, is he among these things? Hallelujah. So, do you go to the shop? You go to Ikea or Lidl to go and buy wisdom? Is it available there? Let's look at what the scripture says, verse 12. He said, but where shall wisdom be found? Hallelujah. He said, where shall wisdom be found? And where is the place of understanding? Man knoweth not the branch thereof. Neither is it found in the land of the living. So you can travel from Sweden to America, from America to Lagos, from anywhere, go to anywhere. It is not found there. He said, the depth said it is not in me, and the sea said it is not with me. With me, intellectual wisdom, or the professors of this world, the intellectual of this world, they don't have it. Verse 15, he said, it cannot be gotten for gold, neither shall silver be weighed for the price here. So, you can't buy it. You cannot buy it with money. Verse 16, he said, it cannot be valued with the gold of Ophir, with the precious onyx, or the sapphire. So talking about the precious stone, you cannot say, okay, I've got diamond here, man. I'm looking for divine wisdom. You can have 10,000 of diamond. You cannot get to divine wisdom, sir. Thank you, Jesus. He said, the gold and the crystal cannot equal it, and the exchange of fish cannot be for the jewels of fine gold. Say, no mention shall be made of coral or of pearls, for the price of wisdom is above rubies. It's above what money can buy. Yet the topaz of Ethiopia shall not equal it, neither shall it be valued with the pure gold. Verse 20. He said, whence then cometh wisdom? And where is the place of understanding? Seeing it is hid from the eyes of all living and kept close from the fowl of the air. You know the fowl of the air? Those wink people. You know them. Everybody smiles. They don't have it. The occultic people, they don't have it. The witches don't have it. Forget about those who are celebrating witches now and are buying all those rooms around here. They don't have it. The wisdom of God, they don't have it. Hallelujah. Thank God they don't have it. They will have taken over the entire world anyway. Thank you, Jesus. He said, seeing it is hid from eye of all living and kept close from the fowls of the air. He said, destruction and death says, we have had the fame thereof with our eyes. So destruction and even death, they are afraid of the wisdom of God. Verse 23 said, God understandeth the way thereof, and he knoweth the place thereof. For he looketh to the ends of the earth, and seeth under the whole heaven. Said, to make the way for the winds, and he weigheth the water by measure. Said, when he made a decree for the rain, and a way for the lightning of the thunder, said, then did he see it, and declare it. He prepared it, yea, and shut it out. And unto man he said, behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The fear of the Lord is wisdom. And to depart from evil is understanding. No wonder he said in Deuteronomy 28, he said, if you will diligently hearken to do all these commandments, he said, you shall be above all nations. Hallelujah. The wisdom of God will at any time place you on high. And that wisdom is only available in God. No other being can ever give it to you. king has the custody of it. No pastor has the custody of it. The Bible said that the spirit of wisdom came upon Joshua when the man of God, Moses, laid hand on him. It was not the wisdom of Moses. It was the wisdom of God that God took, because he deposited it in Moses. He took it and transferred it to Joshua. But it was not the wisdom of Moses. Because the wisdom of Moses could only end him up in runaway thing that he did. Hello? You know, he tried to pay them. He saw them fighting and said, you kill somebody. See, his own wisdom could only end him in slavery. But when the wisdom of God came, he said, that same rod that you are using, put it down. And this rod, it don't marry wood. I've been using it to beat all those stubborn goats. I'll say, yeah, I'm going to beat that stubborn goat again. There's one stubborn goat in Egypt, I will deal with him. The wisdom of God. The wisdom of God. Somebody's body is being somehow. They take communion. The wisdom of God. The wisdom of God. You see, after taking it by faith, you will see God rising. Rising up and what? And subduing every flaw. The wisdom of God. The wisdom of God. He said, oh, this thing is happening. Anointing. He said, I do have it to anointing. It's not real oil. You take it to Uppsala. Take it to Uppsala University. Analyze it chemically. Start speaking grammar. No. Once you pray and you touch it and you believe in it, the power of God, it becomes the power of God. Jesus was sending them forth. Bible said he gave them power. And they came back and they said, we hear the sea. Even devils were fleeing by the world. And we showed up. Why? The power of God in the oil. Somebody will say, I went to the University of Cambridge. I studied theology. In fact, I studied David for 10 years. I've analyzed this thing. It's just ordinary chemical. Yes, you are just speaking grammar. Bible made us to understand that the wisdom of God is surpasses every intelligence of men, sir. Thank you, Jesus. Right? The wisdom of God runs home. He says, submit. Say, how can I submit? I cannot submit to him when he doesn't even understand anything like me. I'm just earning. I'm earning more than him. In fact, as a matter of fact, I went to a better school than him. He says, submit. Hello? Thank you, Jesus Christ. So what are we talking about? The source of the wisdom of God is from God. Colossians 2:2-3. He said, that their heart might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God, and of the Father, and of Christ, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. The wisdom, the treasure of wisdom, the treasure of the wisdom of God is hidden in Christ Jesus. So, until you are in Christ Jesus, you can't get it, sir. Thank you, Jesus. In Proverbs 2, he said, for the Lord giveth wisdom out of his mouth, cometh knowledge and understanding. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is buckler to them that walk uprightly. Lord giveth wisdom. Hello? Remember Solomon? He didn't say, okay, I was born by very wealthy people. You know when Solomon took over the reins of power? Solomon had enough resources that would last him his lifetime, even if he refused to work. But Solomon did not say, okay, I've got him plenty of money. His money is everything, you know, I don't need any other thing. No. He cried for wisdom, said, these people that you asked me to rule, I need your wisdom to rule them, sir. Without your wisdom, it will be impossible to succeed as a king. And as long as he was holding on to that wisdom, look at what he did. Thank you, Jesus. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 5. Proverbs 4, 5. The Bible did not make us to understand that you just wait in one way. I mean, sit in one corner and bam, you wake up, bam, and wisdom just falls on you. No, sir. He said, get wisdom. Say, get wisdom.
Get wisdom.
You know, get is an action word. It means run after wisdom. Lay hold on wisdom. Place value on it. He said, get wisdom. Get understanding. Forget it not. Neither decline. life from the words of my mouth. Forsake her not. That means after getting it, don't let her go. And she shall preserve thee. Love her, and she shall keep thee. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. And with all thy getting, get understanding. Get understanding. See, where people that are celebrated today are people that have strange order of understanding of any subject. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. You see, when we're talking about those who are specialists or a professor in any field, he's a professor because he has more understanding than others. Hallelujah. Amen. When we're talking about tactician, when you talk about the lack of football, you know what they do is that they will study the opponent. He said, okay, this is their main man, this is their point man. You remember, I think, was it one of our World Cups? They say, okay, they know that Amikachi and Amunike was our main man then. Italy, yeah. He said, God forgive you, Italians. Hallelujah. He said, take care of those two guys. Once you paralyze the two guys, they will be confused. Didn't they deal with us? It means it's so simple. When you say somebody is a tactician, it simply means that he has understood that subject. He knows when to hit. He knows when not to hit. When you are fighting with those who fight taekwondo, they know where to hit you, or the police, if they are doing ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, they know where to hit you no matter how tall you are, you fall flat within 1 second. They have the understanding of that subject. That's why. Otherwise, he will just be doing like this. I've seen you wear two men. He wasted time to teach us right. What I'm talking about is that go for wisdom. Because wisdom is the principal thing. He has declared, and he will not lie. That song said, he has said, how do they sing it? He has promised, he will never, he will fail. He will never fail. What we need is wisdom. We need the wisdom of God. As we close, let's quickly look at the attitude that we need to put into place for us to enjoy supernatural wisdom. Because your attitude determines your altitude in life. Hallelujah. Your attitude cannot be seen physically, but the result of it can be seen. Hello? Somebody can say, okay, yes, I'm getting what you are saying. Yes, you are getting it. But by the time you ask him to apply what you are teaching him, you see him doing, you know, talking so much, you didn't get it. His attitude wasn't right towards knowledge. That's why you can force the child to go to school. You can force him to learn. You can manipulate somebody and attack him to come to church. You say, okay, if you come to church, we'll give you this, we'll give you that. But you cannot force them to listen. You cannot force them to cooperate with the word of God. You cannot force them to abide with the word of God, or abide with God. It depends on his attitude. So what attitude do we need to put into play for us to download divine wisdom? Because divine wisdom doesn't fall on people. Hello?
Hi.
Number one, attitude that we need to put into place. What I call wisdom habits here. Number one is love for God and love for humanity. Hallelujah. Love for God and love for humanity. If we want to flow in the wisdom of God, you must have the love of God burning in your heart and love for man. A selfish man cannot flow in the wisdom of God. Everything in his life is about me, my wife, my children, and my baby, grandpa, whatever. Everything doesn't even flow to any other person. It's only him and him and him. You cannot flow in divine wisdom with that. Go and see all inventors in life. There are people that say, no, this thing can't continue. There must be a cure for this sickness. Lord, show me. I can't watch humanity die without a solution. I have heart for them. Yes, you see. And God will say, yes, I'm showing the way. You see people that made difference in their generation. You see people like Job. You think God just gave Job that word for nothing. Because God knew that if he released that word for him, he won't watch the fatherless go to bed without food. He won't want the widows weeping without helping them. He won't want them. He won't want the oppressed society, the slaves, just suffering. He knew that his heart was panting after God. Compassion was boiling in him. Do you have compassion? Thank you, Jesus Christ. If a and labor
in another country to make it. Is it just for you? Or because you can't watch people suffering? No, I want to do something.
Remember when I was speaking with one of my friends, and I said, remember what I used to say in school?
I said, I hate wasting. I hate going to, what is this market in Lagos? It's in my 12. Seeing mangoes, tomatoes, rotting away. I said, if I have an opportunity to travel abroad, I want to go and learn how to preserve fruit. I want to be an agro-allied industrialist so that to solve the problem that you are passing through. See, if you see people like David, God empowered him so that he knew that he would do something to defend Israel. This was a child, a teenager. He said, I can't watch this nonsense Goliath speaking against my God. No, I can't watch it. No wonder God endowed him with that wisdom. His brothers were there. They were taller than him, more popular. They were more popular in the home. In fact, when the prophet came to anoint him, the father did not even remember that he existed. He was just forgotten, left over. Because naturally, in Israel, it was the elderly one that was supposed to be taking care of the animals. Remember in the time of Joseph? Joseph was home, isn't it? It was the brother that time, the brother was there. But in the case of David, the youngest boy, you put him in the field, others were having party at home. If they didn't like him, but because he had heart for God, the love of God will not make God to pass him by. The love of God will not make the gentle Savior to pass him by. Do you love God? Is your heart panting after God? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I love one of our brothers. He said, Pastor, if I'm able to get the car, I want to get the car that I can use to move more people to church. How can that person not have more, sir? Hello? See, let your life flow to order. Don't let a month pass by without falling to somebody, sir. And at your level, you can do something. Don't say, I don't have anything. You are lying, sir. Because one crowd can make a difference in somebody's life. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Let your hand pass after God. 1 Corinthians 8. 1 Corinthians 8:1-2-3. He said, now, as touching offer unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge perfect all. He said, make people proud. That's knowledge without God. That's in 1 Corinthians 8:1-2-3. He said, but charity or love edifies, it builds up. And if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing. Because knowledge, casual knowledge or online knowledge, it makes people to become proud. So he said, if you think that you have known all, someone is speaking to you, you don't want to listen. You see, you have not known anything yet, as you ought to know. Verse 3. He said, but if any man love God, the same is known of him. So loving God qualifies you to have the revelation of the knowledge of God. John 14:21. He that has my commandment, Jesus speaking in John 14:21, and keepeth my commandment, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me, he shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and I will manifest myself to him, or I will show myself to him. Remember, wisdom is a correct application of knowledge. The knowledge that you don't know, you don't have, you cannot apply it. And God said, he will grant you knowledge when you love him. Hallelujah. He will reveal deep things to you. He will reveal the secret to you, if only and if you love him. If his love is burning in your heart, if it is not fake love, thank you, Jesus Christ. Love that says, no matter what, I will follow him. Whether it's convenient or not, I will follow him. Hello? Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I was about to say, the place is far. Yes, it's far. But when you are incapacitated, you think of. Anybody can say, I love God. Anybody can preach. It's not my title. You can preach to make money. You can preach to talk because you don't have anything doing. You can preach to please people. Oh, because of that, my daddy is expecting me to be a pastor because my daddy is a pastor. I want to be a pastor too. To please daddy. Are you preaching because you love God?
Hello, sir.
Are you crying for the church to be full so that the gate of hell will be crying, or you want to go around bragging, I am the pastor of the biggest church in my city?
Do you love God?
Jesus answered unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my word, and my father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him.
So when you love God, you enjoy revelation, and revelation is the cure for frustration. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
Lord. Number two, attitude. Remember, number one said the love of God and love of humanity. Number two attitude is meekness. Say meekness.
Meekness.
Say meekness.
Meekness.
This is where we are going. This one is a hard pill to swallow. May God have mercy on us in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Psalm 25 and verse 9. Psalm 25 verse 9. He said, the meek will he guide in judgment, and the meek will he teach his way. Psalm 25 and verse 9. He said, the meek. What is meekness? Is he going there? Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Every time. It's not me. That's not meekness. That's good. Everybody can say yes, sir. Yes, sir. But inside him, he's as proud as anything. That's the truth. Hallelujah. In Matthew 5:5, he said, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are the meek. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Meekness is a readiness to bow all time, at all costs, to the authority of the word of God. Hello? Readiness to bow to the authority of the word of God. Your flesh, my flesh doesn't feel like doing it. My flesh as a man doesn't feel like loving a woman that is not submissive. But the word of God said I should do it. So I go for it. It simply means that the word of God is the last authority. Living a word-ruled life, that is meekness. Hello? Remember, spirituality is not ability to just make noise and to go to church regularly. No. Spirituality, you know, it can be described or can be defined as the level of the compliance of your life with the word of God. Is your life word ruled? Or is ruled by emotions? Hello? Because emotion will not tell you to go and say sorry when you are right. Is there that God? Far older than me. I even remember when I was in university, I was already in primary school. But God said, come and say sorry. Yeah. They hold me. The moment you say that, you quench their spirit. Meekness simply means obeying the word of God at all costs. Your body is not feeling like it. It's aching. The word of God said, and then they will say, I'm strong. Yeah, for real. Daddy, this thing is paining, you know. It's paining, you know. Yes, that's your emotion. You want to keep that pain there. Hello? Living the word of God to be the authority in your life, that's what meekness is. Thank you, Jesus. Never assume the position of arrival, this arrival mentality. Say, oh, now I have everything. I've got, I'm the chief executive officer of my own company, and as a matter of fact, they are just planning to make me the balogun of my community. Yes, I'll be the balogun. Whatever balogun, what next? Thank you, Jesus. Don't ever assume arrival's mentality. See, even when things that we do that have been doing again and again, if you watch the game, you can almost always learn something new to do. That's what they call research. You know, research came from two words. Research or search again. That's why, you know, the people in the West, they advance. Why? They keep on doing research. They don't play with data. They say, okay, last year, we did this. These are the inputs. We came about with this product. Now, what can we do again? Oh, last 6 years, this thing came down. The 6 years before, this thing came down. Does it mean that every six years, this thing has to come down? You research again. Thank you, Jesus Christ. So, meekness makes you to always open, to learn at every time. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ.
everything. I go to the toilet, go to pick the kids, I put my earphone on my ear, listening and learning, sir. No one about the faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith does not come by assumption, sir. Faith does not come by feeling. Faith does not come because of your position. But faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The word of God is the wisdom of God. So the more you hear the word, the more you flow in divine wisdom.
Thank you, Jesus Christ. So let's assume position of meekness. Meekness. Moses, this was a man that God used to open the Red Sea. The strongest kingdom at that time was subdued by this same man. Do you know ordinary Jethro was one that showed him secret of administration? This man sat down the whole day. Hey, Israel, everybody line up. What did you do? You slapped your husband. Okay, okay, we look at the case. By the time he finished judging the case, the whole day would have passed and become so tired. They carry him. Baba, what do you want to eat? Pap. Say no. Jethro said, you will kill yourself this way. With all your anointing, you will kill yourself. Why don't you appoint people to be Lord, to be handling it? Teachability is what we call humility. Ability to be able to learn at convenient and inconvenient times, even when you are insulted. Hallelujah. You know, if you are going to master and say, hey, Jethro, can you show me the way to master? Yeah, as soon as you don't know it, this is the way. And they show the correct way. He said, no, he insulted me. I won't follow that way. I'm going to the other way. Why don't you have to tell him? Hello? So, sometimes you can even call us insult. But see, when your mind is open, a humble person, you will see what can I learn from this. You go ahead and master your teacher's time. Quickly, number three. Is uprightness. Say uprightness.
Uprightness.
If you want to flow divine wisdom in uprightness, you mean righteousness must be your watchword. If you don't embrace holiness, forget about the wisdom of God. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Uprightness is synonymous with righteousness. Remember, we have said righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to a people. You can never sin a wayward nation. That is making it. It's not possible. You can never see a generation of people that are wayward last few years that their children are head are lifted up except they repent. That's the truth. So don't join them to cut corners. Hello? So that you won't be cut short. Don't join them to cut corners. Say, okay. If they say, oh, that's the popular thing, everybody is doing it. Don't join them to do it, sir. It's risky. It is a satanic trap. To end your career, to return there, you will not be trapped in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Gehazi had the opportunity to flow in that wisdom. But because of money, he lost out. He won't lose out in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Daniel chapter 1 and verse 8. That's the reference. Thank you, Jesus. Also the reference is that of Joseph. Genesis 39, 10 through 13. Joseph flowed in divine wisdom. Do you know the interpretation of the dream didn't come from, he didn't learn it from any university. Okay, which university will you go to that they will teach you how to interpret to you? I like some people are doing it now. You know, they say, come and we have school of astrology, we teach you how to interpret. They will just go, what they will simply do is that they will teach the spirit to open yourself up and they will release the, what you call the spirit? A familiar spirit unto you, it's a demon. And that familiar spirit has the ability to know something because they have some level of access into the spirit here, and they will then use you to show them things. But that's risky because it's express way to wear. Hello? Thank you, Jesus Christ. So he interpreted the dream by the wisdom of God. Daniel interpreted the dream by the wisdom of God. So, and there, you can see that both of them, they live holy life. Daniel refused to corrupt himself. He refused to join the corruption of the day. He said, I would rather die than join the corruption. Joseph said, I would rather die than fall and sin with this woman. No, sir. So, when you embrace holiness, you flow in divine wisdom. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Psalm 25 verse 12. He said, what a man is he that fears the Lord? Him shall he teach the way that he shall go. Remember, Job, as we read, said the fear of the Lord. What? You know, wisdom. So said that with joy shall you draw water out of the wells of salvation. And the wells of salvation, we have power, we have riches, now we are dealing with wisdom. So without joy, you cannot access divine wisdom. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Philippians 4:4. Say, rejoice in the Lord always. And I say again, rejoice. Rejoice. As you are rejoicing, the Bible says that God inhabited the praises of his people. Isn't it? So when you rejoice and the presence of God is with you, you know, when somebody is with you, you chiefly enjoy his wisdom. Hello? You know, if I'm with a medical doctor and he has some level of wisdom in that area and my heart starts choking, you know, he can advise me and say, oh, do this, what to do, because I'm close to him. But if you don't have anyone, if you're not close to him, you have to send somebody to him. The same way, when you are close to God, when you attract his presence, you will always hear his voice and he will tell you what to do. And wisdom is doing what God asked you to do. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Philippians 4:8 said, finally, Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, said, finally, brethren, whatsoever thing are true, whatsoever thing are honest, whatever things are just, whatever things are of good report. Thank you, Jesus. So if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think of this thing. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Let's just round up here. One of the attitudes that we need to put up is tenacity. Say tenacity.
Tenacity.
What is tenacity? Tenacity is talking about uncompromised commitment. Uncompromised commitment to any cause. You want to do it, you want to do something. You don't say, hey, I've tried. It's not working. I want to leave it. It doesn't work that way. Tenacity talks about dedication. To be deadly committed to something. Say, I want to do it. Remember, this man, Isaac Newton, was sitting there and said, okay, this apple is falling down. Boom, boom, every day. Why? It wasn't the first day that he thought about it, and he got the answer. Say, why did it fall? Why did it go up? The man that invented electricity, he tried many times. He failed. Was it Faraday? Yeah. He failed and failed and failed and failed and failed. He refused to give up. So tenacity is refusing to give up. See, this issue, according to the word of God, it is written, through his poverty, I shall be made rich. But it is also written that causes everyone that hangeth on the tree, and the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentile. Lord, why is my man not going in that prosperity? Somebody, and see, some spirit will still tell you and say, ah, do you remember your grandfather? Is it going to end well? Remember even that your brother? You see, in your family, created to make it. We don't know, it's true. And that person will just continue. See, the devil just transfer that poverty to his life. But somebody say, no, I refuse. I will fight the good fight of faith. So tenacity means fighting the good fight of faith, refusing to quit. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Refusing to quit. And that's how wisdom will come. See, naturally, when you focus on something, when you concentrate on something, you will know more about it, isn't it? Hello? Do you know that even music, when you listen to it again and again, there are times there are words you didn't hear before that will just come. Hello? There are places you have been driving and been passing and passing and passing, you didn't see things there. But maybe something happened, and maybe you have to park urgently in that area. Say, so this thing is like this. Oh, so this shop is here, I didn't know. So, when you pay attention to something, it is natural that you will excel in that thing. And tenacity talks about paying attention, refusing to quit. Say, I will not quit. Say, I will not quit.
I will not quit.
Thank you, Jesus. Luke 9:23. And he said to them, oh, Luke 9:23. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. For whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. Hello? This is talking about continual discipleship. The closer you follow, the more wisdom you get from him. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
When it is to Jesus.
You know, this thing is easy to come from all the way from Sudatelia to this place. No. Naturally, there must be something that has motivated you to come. You think it's easy to sit down under 3 hours and listen to him, a message? It's not, naturally. Because there are spirits that say, no, don't listen. If you're watching football, even if it is extra time and extra time, and they even postpone the following day, you still go. Hello? You know, there are situations where the match was not completed, maybe because of weather issue. Hello? And they say, keep your ticket, though. Come the following day. You will still call them at work. Hello? What? I can't come. Why? My body is somehow. You know, he wants to go and watch the game. Hello? Because he's committed to it. Hallelujah. So, whatever you are committed to, you excel there. It's natural. So, when you are committed to the Word of God, when you stay with the Word of God, you will excel there. Hallelujah to Jesus. You committed. Look at what the example I gave yesterday. I tell you something. Immediately I saw that scripture, I said, man, washing dishes. No. I couldn't sit. I said, no, I must take it out. I went. Even I was sitting in the toilet, I said, okay, let me open my Bible. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ. People have talked about divine partiality. They say, Jesus prayed for Peter. He didn't pray for the rest of the apostles. I say, can this be true? No. Lord, something must happen. Because your word said, God is not a spirit of oppression. I must see it. I kept on digging. And as I was digging, I just saw that word. Bam! He said, when Jesus said, Satan has the plan to shift you as wheat. The word you there was a plural word. He was addressing all of them, not only Peter, sir. So when you pay attention, you have been reading that scripture before. Read it again. Don't say, when they ask you to read it in church, I know that scripture. Our Father, who art in heaven. You are just chatting and chatting like ram. You won't learn nothing like that. Go to it again. Go and you say, Mr. Mara. What are you saying? Thank you, Jesus Christ. What other attitude that we need to put up forward to? Versatility. Be versatile. Thank you, Jesus. It means to be versed in your mind. Hello? And especially if there's any people that need this one, it's people of grand scale. Somebody said, if you want to hide something from a black man, put it in a book and keep it in the library. We don't read. Hello? We don't read. A black man is ready to do and work and get tired. But when it comes to knowledge, he doesn't appreciate it. Place value on it. Load yourself. Don't say, okay, no, I am a banker. I don't have any interest in engineering. Let's stand up. Thank you, Jesus. Be versatile. Hallelujah. Amen. Be versatile. Have diversity of knowledge. And especially those of us that we are parents. We need to know about our environment. Your son comes home, or your daughter comes home with something. You don't know about it. You are wicked, you. Maybe you know something that is good. Hello? Don't say, okay, no. I belong to the old class. I'm the old school. Old school, yeah, but you need this to you. So that the devil will not deceive you and snatch your children away from you. Especially in this world we are living in right now. We need to be sensitive. They come home with things. They don't understand it. There are things that they put around in their hand that have a occultic symbol. Hello? Even you go to shop, even by mistake, you order for something, they put some symbol on it. You see it and say, no, this one, no. I'd rather trash it and allow you to wear this one. Because once you have your symbol, you know it's natural, even in science, if you know the machine that is sorting out fruit, it deserves to sense a particular thing. The same way, when you have a particular mark, when that demon is moving, he sees that mark on you. See, this one of us. You remember? If those who belong to occultic guys in school, you have your kind of beret. Yes. They are our guy. They know him. The same way, when you go around with occultic symbol, they will identify you. The devil will not take advantage of you in the name of Jesus Christ. So be versatile. Study well. That's the meaning. Don't say, okay, I don't like that. You read the Bible only. No. Yes, you know, we need to work to be sensitive about our environment. Thank you, Jesus Christ. And last one, be a good planner. Want to flow in divine wisdom? Be a good planner. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Be a good planner. Say a good planner.
A good planner.
A good planner. God is a planner. He didn't wake up and say, okay, I've created the fishes. Now I'm going to kill them all. But
stay on top of the trees? No, they can't stay. Let's think of somebody somewhere else. No.
He already created the water where they will live before he created the fishes.
Hello?
Be a good planner. What is the plan of God? What's your plan for your family? What's your plan for your pension? What's your plan for your business? What's your plan for your children? You know, that will help you to contain your spending even. So that you won't spend your tomorrow today. Hello? It will be, you know, there are times I tell my children, I say, no, this money, yes. If you want this thing, we can afford to give it. But we have something that is more important now. Let's invest this one. Because even when we depart, when we finish our race, we will still enjoy it. So let's sow it there. You can have this cloth, you can have this shoe, you can have this one, but are we investing it? You don't know that when you invest maybe 1,000 grand today, what will it be next 10 years? But a cloth that you buy today, I'm telling you the next month, another style has come out. They won't respect it. Hello? They don't respect it. I mean, I've noticed that when I was in school. If we say, okay, oh, G-boys in school, you go to get a very nice jeans. Yes, we used to brag about that. You know, you are the first set of people that will go to, what is it, Balogun and then. That's why I tell you, post your in the campus. Before you know what's happening, by the time the semester goes and the people come back, everybody will just say, kind of jeans. You won't be able to wear it again. And somebody will go and steal to get that same jeans. Hello? So be a planner. Think! That's the meaning. Let's begin to give me praise. Think before you act. Plan. Jesus said, who among you? In Luke 14, 28 to 30. Say, for which of you intended to build a tower, sitteth not down first, and counted the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it, lest haply after he had laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, and all that build it, they begin to mock him. They will not mock you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Your enemies will not mock you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Every step that you will take, that people will say, that will open up for mockery, you will not take you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. But this calls for what? For planning, thinking, use your mind, that's the meaning. Let's give him thanks, first of all, for the availability of divine wisdom, the wisdom of God that is going to rule and reign by. Let's give him thanks. Let's give him glory. Let's give him honor. Let's give him honor. Let's give him honor. Give him thanks. Give him thanks. Give him thanks. Give him thanks. Exalt his name. Bless his holy name. Bless his holy name. Bless his holy name. Worship him. Give him praise. Give him glory. Give him honor. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Here he said, wisdom will always locate a planner. Because at the process of planning, wisdom flows. It's natural when you are planning for something. There are times when you think, oh, this thing I want to do it. And you just assume everything is done. By the time you start, you say, it's more complicated than I think. But see, as you are planning, okay, now this year, this is my plan. I want to achieve this one. Oh, next year is what I want to do. Oh, this year, I'm starting my home, this is what I want to do. You don't just do things anyhow. Hello? Even when you have friends around you who are not planners, who like calling you, say, hey, what are you doing? Let's go to Central together. To do what? Just to look at the trains. Okay, I'm coming. Let's talk tomorrow. Not today. Hello? Because they don't have anything to do with their lives. You say, Mr. Lamboja, what are you doing? I'm just relaxing. That's cool. Oh, let's go there. And as we are going, didn't tell you they are going to rob. Put you in his car. You are not part of them. But if they arrest, they say, you are part of them now. You will not be deceived in the name of Jesus Christ. Be a planner. Plan when you wake up, what do I want to do with my time today? So when you look at my table, one of the things that is always there, that is not missing, is that I'll make a list. Today, I'm doing this, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. Even sometimes I don't finish all, but it guides my day. By the time I come back late in the night, I look at it and say, I didn't finish it. Let me try and still do so. It's better you have a list that you are unable to finish than not to have any list at all. Don't just live your life anyhow. Say, whatever will happen, will happen. Nothing will happen that way, sir. Greatness doesn't come by chance. Thank you, Jesus Christ. But as the Lord liveth, you will rule and reign
as kings in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah. In your career,
you will rule and reign in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
In your business, you will rule and reign in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Even concerning your health, you will rule over weakness in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
You know, wisdom of God, it demands sensitivity.
Hello?
It demands sensitivity. The wisdom, you know, there are some food you take. You notice that every time I take this food, my body behaves somehow. We don't demand that maybe you reduce the quantity of that food. But you don't take it at all.
Hello? I say, ah, no. And you are offered that food. Say, oh. Say, no.
You eat it. And you go home. You are holding your tummy. There's no wisdom in that. This body, you need it, sir. This body will take you to palaces in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
It will take you to high places of life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Every cancer of Ahithophel that will bring you down, you will not follow it in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Every Sanballat and Tobiah that want to break down your destiny, God will drive them far away from you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
In this year of divine enlargement, even without speaking it out, it will be evident that God is working it in your life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You will not take a step that will make you to end up in the pit in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You will not go to a place where you will end up in the mortuary in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Your children will not go to a place where their head will be cut off in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Father, I commit your people into your able hands, O God. Let your help locate them on every side in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let your help locate them on every side in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Everyone that says you will not go, we go for you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
This particular week, as we are celebrating his triumphant entrance or entry into the temple, the King of Glory will reflect his glory in your life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The King of Glory will show forth his nature in your career in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
When he enter, he cleansed the temple. And therefore decree that everything that's not of God in your life, everything that's not of God in your family, everything that's not of God in your career will be flushed away in the name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
You are here, you are saying amen. By next Sunday, you will not be found in the mortuary in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Your children will not be found in the mortuary in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Everyone that are numbered with you will not be found in the mortuary in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Blessed be your holy name, Lord.
Yeah.
Father, everyone that is saying amen here, those people that you have called to be in this ministry and have been faithful in all ways, my Lord, meet them at the point of their needs in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You have called this ministry the ministry of restoration. Lord, let them come back next Sunday with testimony of restoration in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Father.
Blessed be your name, Lord.
Thank you for listening to this message. However, I want to remind you that God loves you so much that he gave his only begotten Son for the entire world, including you, to be saved from sin and all its consequences. It therefore does not make any sense to spend the next minute of your life without accepting Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. God bless you as you believe and confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior right now. Hallelujah.